Hey, so a couple of you were asking me questions about the Triumph and what the progress of the TR project was. So I thought I'd take this little video so you guys can see where we're at with it and see what it's like to drive the car. So what you're looking at is a 1958 Triumph TR3. The car did not have a matching engine when I bought it, so the transplant of the 302 V8, while sacrilegious to some, is not anywhere near as bad as if the car had had matching numbers. The TR3 was the first sports car to come out of the UK that would do over 100 miles an hour and also have the safety of disc brakes, as you can probably see from the advertising I have in front of the license plate right there. It's a lovely little car. It still probably does 100 miles an hour. I wouldn't know that, of course, but I think it might. The side pipes are not original on the car. It had regular exhaust pipes running back through the back, so we've got this kind of Cobra-esque feel to it. That was primarily to get the heat out as quickly as possible, and also to give me as much room underneath the car as I possibly could. And of course, there's a style aspect to it too. As you can see as well, this is a work in progress. We still have to do paint. We've got to do upholstery and carpet and put it back together and make it look really nice. But mechanically speaking, we're in pretty good shape, with the exception of the fact that we're still using the original Triumph rear end. We're evaluating right now whether we should take that rear end out and replace it with a Ford 8-inch rear end, which would then make the entire drivetrain Ford. So Ford engine, Ford gearbox, and then a Ford rear end. Here's the dashboard. Obviously, the glove box is not in the vehicle at the moment. But you can see, I'll go close here, odometer, carbon fiber, ultralight gauges, RPMs, miles per hour, and then the four-pack is fuel, water, oil, and voltage. And in this car, the big Achilles heel really is the water temperature. We have a huge engine in the car. It was designed for a much smaller engine, and shedding heat has been a challenge. It's been successful so far. It's been getting up into the 90s here in Chicago, and we've still been able to get the heat out of it and run about 180 to 190 degrees Fahrenheit. So here's the car. The silver stuff is the insulation that we use to keep the heat outside the car and not in the engine compartment itself. And then I'll zip down here. Hopefully you can see these pedals. They are floor-mounted racing pedals, and it's a bit of a tangled mess in there, but here's what they look like. Tall drivers need not apply for driving the Triumph. All right, I'm going to go ahead and switch down. I'll open up the engine compartment. You can have a look at that, and then we'll take it for a spin. Okay, so here's the engine compartment. Now, most of what you see in here is off-the-shelf parts that I had to carefully select, really, to get the engine and all of its ancillary equipment to fit into the car. We did push the firewall back right here and made a new crescent shape here in order to get the motor far enough back. It wasn't a width issue, but we wanted to be able to put a standard motor, water pump, and so forth behind the rack and pinion that is now in this car. It actually has a Mini Cooper rack and pinion instead of the steering box it had originally. So from a wiring perspective, this wiring harness you see here obviously needs to be tidied up, but that is a wiring harness made by a guy who also had a V8 conversion in his Triumph, in his little British car, and he was an electrical engineer, and he made these wiring harnesses. So I'm very lucky to have one of these. It's fully modern, and I've rewired the entire vehicle with it, so there's no more Lucas electrics in here to let the smoke out. From an exhaust header perspective, down here, these are standard block header exhaust headers. You can see that they do fit quite nicely, and there have been no problems with temperature from the header being, you know, maybe a quarter of an inch or so away from the side of the vehicle. Everything's pretty standard otherwise. Holley carburetor, Edelbrock intake manifold, 100 amp hot rod alternator, and then I'm not sure if you're going to be able to see this, but we have a hot rod aluminum radiator in here, a multi-core radiator with a very powerful electric fan, and shrouds on the left and right-hand sides of the aluminum radiator that are matched to the curves of the fender, so that pretty much every molecule of air that comes in through the front of the car is going through the radiator, and that has become vital in these hot summer months here. You can see also that we had to put in a remote oil filter. There just simply wasn't room to get the oil filter on the engine like we normally would have it. Steering is on a couple of custom brackets that I did have to weld up, these two black guys right here. And then the steering rod is hot rod Borgeson with Borgeson U-joints. It's all standard stuff and easily available, and it worked perfectly. And then we also have a three reservoir system here. Now this is a hydraulic clutch, circuit for the front brakes and circuit for the rear brakes. And I did that to ensure some extra safety. So should I lose a circuit, there'll be another circuit to pick up and hopefully totally be able to stop the vehicle. So there you go. That's what it looks like when you put a V8 inside a Triumph TR3, at least the way we did it. Next, let's go for a spin. Okay, so now you're mounted on the bonnet of the vehicle. Let's hope you stay there safe and sound, but you should be able to get a good bird's eye view and hopefully hear what it's like to drive this car.